Hey, everybody. Welcome back to another fantastic edition of the show. Thank you for tuning in to this episode. We are excited to bring you yet another fantastic guest that has a whole lot of knowledge and information to share with you on your journey to taking dominion over your money and your life.
Yes, super excited to have. She is now returning on our show. I think we had on our show, when we first started.
Yeah, man.
Maybe five, 7 years ago. Yes, OG and we consider her a friend of ours. Definitely
in the finance. She's fancy now, though.
Oh, my gosh. She's doing great things.
We're still on her list or not.
Super excited to have Tiffany Aliche.
New York Times best-selling author. We got to put it out there. Of the brand new book, Get Good with Money. And she's here to talk about all that stuff to help you. Get good with your money. Get your pen and paper out or your notes app, like we always tell you, because we bring you the guests that you need to pay close attention to. So get ready to learn some good stuff. And let's get Tiffany on so we can hear all about it. Hey, Tiffany, welcome back to the His and Her Money Show.
Thank you for having me. And yes, and for those of you who don't know, I'm better known as the Budgetnista. You might be like, Tiffany Aliche, who's that?
That's so true.
It's just the Budgetnista girl.
That's the Budgetnista. Yes, super excited to have you back on our show. You're going to be talking about this new great book. But before you get into that, let everybody know a little bit about who you are and what you do.
Who is Tiffany the Budgetnista?
I am a financial educator. I'm an author, speaker, teacher. If I had to bring it down to one word, it definitely would be teacher. And I just happen to teach people, especially women, about money. Although I don't turn anyone away. My husband's always like, you always say women. I'm like, do you listen? Oh, okay. Well, that's why I talk to women.
That's dope.
This,
you said at the heart of everything, you're a teacher. And that's actually where your story started. This whole money journey that you went on from start to finish began with you as a preschool teacher, and you got.
Yes.
On the financial tip, and it springboarded you into the person that you are today. So take us back. We know that you are a New York Times best-selling author right now, helping millions of women across the world get good with money. But take us back to
with a multi-million dollar company.
I'm sorry, did I leave that out?
Like, I'm sure it's on its way to a billion
M's,
dollar company.
Right? M's.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Got it. So before that, though, you was Miss Aliche in the classroom.
Yes.
So what happened way back when that got you started on this journey?
So I actually grew up learning about money. My father, he's retired now, he was an accountant and a CFO. He has his bachelor's in finance and his master's in economics. So he and my mom used to really sit down with me and my four sisters, there's five of us, five girls, and talk about money because, you know, I don't care how much money you make, five kids is tight, you know? And so we would literally have, like, we would have family meetings, like on Thursday, about grades and chores, but we also talked about money. And I remember getting my first job and him showing me what the things on my paycheck meant, or opening our first bank account together. We didn't have a sweet 16. He said, there's too many of y'all to be turning 16. So we're going to have a sweet. We're going to walk down to the bank and open a bank account. So that's what we had. And at the time, you know, I didn't fully appreciate, obviously, all the lessons, because I just thought they were boring at first. And it really wasn't until I want to say that I really got to college when they started to sink in, and I realized how many people, especially my roommates and my suite mates and the people on my floor, didn't understand about money. So they would be asking questions. I'm like, girl, that doesn't even make sense. You know, you don't have to pay that credit card back, right? And I started to almost hear my father come through me like, oh Lord, I'm turning to my daddy. Like, girl, you got money for that. You need to save. And I'm like, I'm my father on the floor. But then other crises would arise and I didn't know how to manage. So I would call him. I remember distinctly that we thought it was funny at first that debt collectors used to call our dorm room for my roommate. And I, you know, I'm 17, 18. So we're prank calling like, hello. Yes, this is Cynthia. You know, and I was telling my dad, I'm like, daddy, you know, my roommate has debt collectors calling the room. Isn't that crazy? And he was like, wait, no. He had me put her on the phone and walk through what happened and then coached us both through what to say. And I was like, oh, but you know, once you get that lesson, you never forget it. So when the next roommate had an issue, we knew what to say. And so that's really kind of how the Budgetnista began. It was learning from home and then finding people in my actual life that were struggling and first giving my father's advice and then taking additional courses and classes and life lessons myself. And then really giving advice from a place of I've been there, I've made those mistakes and from my teacher background, you know, here step-by-step how to fix them. And so, yeah, they're really the Budgetnista was born at home and then it was perfected at that preschool classroom because I learned, because one, we all know that like God doesn't waste any lessons, you know? And so I thought it seemed so random. Like, why am I teaching preschool? But I realize now that there is no harder age to teach than 3 and 4 year olds because they don't know anything. Like literally you can say, okay, this is red, like an apple. And they're like, oh, okay, what's an apple? You're like, oh, you know, we got to go all the way back. And so to learn to teach little ones, it taught me how to really teach, how to bring someone from a place of no knowledge to knowledge. So I perfected that for 10 years teaching preschool, combined that with my financial lessons. And really, by the time I was teaching preschool, parents used to ask me financial advice. Well, they really, because I worked in the hood and parents would ask me to hold something because I was like in my 20s and they were in their 20s. And they were like, oh, Miss Tiffany, I could hold $20 to payday. And I'd be like, no, but you can come during nap time and I can show you how to budget. And so that's really where the Budgetnista started to take form because I would teach their kids when they were awake and during nap time, parents would come in. I would show them how to do their own taxes. Because when I found out how much they were getting charged by the local tax place, I'm like, what? No, Tanya, come in during nap time. I'm going to show you how to do it. Or how much they were getting charged because they had check cashing. I was like, what? Come in during nap time. I'm going to show you how to open up a bank account. And so the Budgetnista was really formed while I was teaching preschool. I was also teaching their parents. And then when the Great Recession happened and everyone lost their job, I lost mine too. And I really leaned into doing the Budgetnista full time.
Nice.
Wow.
So, you know, you outline 10 principles that we need to know on the journey. But one of the first things that you address is fear and our thought life around money. You had learned all this stuff. You had then experienced some financial woes and you found yourself like really in a down place, just mentally like that. You said, I messed up. I really messed up. Yeah. And some people get to that place and get stuck right there almost permanently because it's like they can't forgive themselves for the mistakes that they made. You had a background in knowing some things that your dad taught you and you took additional classes and you learned some stuff on your own and you still fail. Some people enter into adulthood with none of that and fall on their face and are unable to forgive themselves for the decisions that they've made with their money up to this point. How does someone sitting in that seat get up off the mat to be able to even receive what you're trying to teach them after that?
So, well, one, like so for those of you guys who don't know, I experienced a huge scam. Someone who was supposed to be my friend ended up scamming me and left me $35,000 in credit card debt. Then I was losing my house due to foreclosure because of the recession. I could not afford my mortgage anymore. And then I had this $35,000 in credit card debt. And then I just finished my master's in education. That was $50,000. So I was just about $300,000 in debt. And then I lost my job. And so it was a really scary time. And what I learned first and foremost, because at first I kept it to myself and I was sinking. I call it drowning politely. You know, like everyone's having fun in the pool and you jumped in the deep end, you realize you can't swim, but you don't want to disturb everyone's fun. And so you allow yourself to drown politely. You don't splash, you don't make noise. And that's the worst thing you can do. The best thing to do when you are drowning is to say something, make noise. And so for me making noise was telling my best friend, Linda, you know, and I told her, I was like, because she called me and because she knew she could tell something was wrong. So it's almost like she said, I think Tiffany's having a hard time swimming. And so at first I was like, no, girl, I'm good. Meanwhile, I'm like, I got about 2 more minutes before this is over for me. And she's like, yeah, but we haven't seen you. You don't come out. You don't sound good. And then my voice cracked. And then I just was like, started just splashing. It was like, help, help. I need help. I have all this debt. I don't have a job. I'm losing my house to foreclosure. I am ashamed. I am afraid. I'm embarrassed because I was the go-to person for all things money. Now look at me. And it was then that, you know, just crazy because Linda must have heard me because she just tried to call me. Linda's like, did you call me? Hello. Wow. You know, I'm like, listen, not that girl, right? And so it was then that I realized that Linda gave me the permission I needed to forgive myself. Because she was like, that's it? I'm like, what do you mean? She said, so essentially you tell me you broke. I was like, yeah. She was like, look to the left, look to the right. We all broke. She's like, well, one, girl, it's the recession. Everybody that lost their job. You at home with your parents. She said, I'm calling you from my mama's couch right now. And what? You know? And she normalized what I thought was so terrible, what I was using to kind of like make myself feel bad about myself. And she was like, girl, we're in our 20s. She was like, honestly, you were the only one that was responsible. You know, so welcome to the club of having a hard time. And so once she normalized that, I was able to forgive myself. So, you know, finding someone that you can trust, find you a Linda. I would say get you a Linda, right? Finding a Linda, whether it's your mom, your sister, your significant other, your best friend, you know, someone that you can trust to kind of offload some of that fear. So they can give you the space to see that it's not just you, that, you know, everyone makes those mistakes, you know, and it's not a condemnation of your character, you know, because that's what you're really saying. You're not saying, Tiffany, I made a mistake. You're saying, Tiffany, I am a mistake. And so someone who, you know, who can help you make that shift so you can then forgive yourself, because it's in the forgiveness that you can see the solutions.
So good. There was another powerful statement that I read that you said, and I'm like, people need to hear this, because a lot of people that are listening right now, they're probably working a 9-to-5, right? And maybe they're looking and idolizing someone that has their own business, but it's a lot that comes with running your own business, right? You said you felt more secure making $39,000 a year as a teacher than you did making $39,000 a month as an owner of your own business. Break that down.
So here's why. When I first started teaching preschool, that was my opening salary, $39,000 a year. And then maybe 5 or 6 years into business, I started to, as Tiffany, take home, you know, $39,000 a month, you know, which is like huge. You make it a month, what you used to make in a year. And I was terrified. I did not have a financial plan for the future because of what happened to me during the recession, the scam, the foreclosure, the moving back home with my parents, sleeping on my sister's couch. I didn't realize how much financial anxiety I had built up, that I had so much money saved. I wasn't doing like the things that we know, you know, don't have so much money saved, inflation. You need to invest to grow your money. Even though I knew it intellectually, emotionally, I was so terrified of losing everything again that all I did was any money I made, I saved every single penny of it. It was to the point where I remember when I finally met with a financial advisor, she's like, have you spent any money? Because literally what you made this year is what's in your bank account. You know, like, I think like, I want to say my overall bills were like $2,500 a month. Like, I'm talking about rent, car, food, everything. And I was making $39,000 a month. And she's like, Tiffany, like, so because I was just so terrified of losing it all, I said, well, if I keep all of it, I can't lose it all. And so that's why I came up with the notion of financial wholeness, because here I was, which what most people would call, you know, on really the verge of being financially free, having enough money not to work anymore. Because 2 years of that, you know, you put enough money aside, you could really live off that, you know, like million plus and invest it and live off interest. And, you know, but I was close to financial freedom, but I wasn't financially whole. I didn't have the other components of my financial life on track. And that's why I was living from this place of like post-traumatic broke syndrome, as I call it. And so it wasn't until I actually had to get help. I got a financial advisor that helped me work through. I knew what to do, but she basically had to hold my hand to say, it's okay. We're transferring this money to your retirement account. Okay. And I'm like, okay. You know, like, Tiffany, it's okay. You know, we're going to like, literally, I had so much money saved. The house that I'm living in now, I paid for it cash. That's how much money I had saved. I
paid for it cash. Beautiful home too.
Thank you. Renovated it cash, and I paid off my parents' house cash, and I paid off my student loans cash in 1 year. because I had so much money saved. And on the surface, it looks like, oh, girl, do it. Do you know how much money I lost as a result? To have hundreds of thousands of dollars in savings and not in the market invested? I mean, I lost tens of thousands of dollars, and I knew that. And so, yes, I think that, so for me, when I was writing this book, Financially Whole, I was thinking about that, Tiffany, and I was thinking about people who might be stuck wherever they are, and likely it's because they're stuck on some component of financial wholeness, and I'm wanting them to understand that getting good with money is incorporating all these aspects of financial wholeness, and in doing so, then you will be okay financially.
Legal & General America is a leader in low-cost, high-quality life insurance.
For nearly 70 years, Legal & General America has been providing financial protection to over 1.3 million families and businesses.
LGA makes understanding and applying for life insurance easy.
And agents are standing by to help you find the best coverage to fit your family's needs.
All you have to do is go to hisandhermoney.com/LGA to get a free quote now.
I think this is something that just doesn't get a lot of play, because you're really dealing with the fact, like, for a lot of us, we know how to make money.
Yes.
Right? We've been taught the value of hard work. We've been taught the value of education. We've done those things. We don't know the value of money management. We don't know the value of wealth building. Holy, like you're talking about wholeness. Yeah. Like you said, you knew these things intellectually, but your emotional scars from, what'd you say, post-traumatic growth syndrome. I like that. Yeah. That's dope. it's a real thing. If you go through something traumatic financially, you still feel it, even though things could have completely turned around in the natural. Emotionally, you still feel the pain of that past. So how do we know that you sat down with this financial planner that helped open your eyes a little bit? And intellectually, you knew better, but this financial planner helped you kind of move down the path that you needed to. But how did you dress your emotions? Like, you knew this stuff in your head, but your emotions were holding you back. You sat down with this person, and they kind of had to pull you with a rope in the right direction. For the person listening who is kind of seeing themselves in what you're saying, how do they regulate that emotional part of them that's still holding tight on to every dollar because of thoughts of, I don't want to lose it again?
So whether you're holding tight to every dollar or spending every dollar because you're like, YOLO, I'm not trying to, you know, I grew up broke and I don't want to live like that. It really starts by saying, you have to acknowledge that I had to acknowledge something was wrong. So it took me a while to even recognize something was wrong, because on the surface, saving money is good. You know, but it's almost like drinking too much water. You can actually drink so much water that you actually drown yourself on the inside. And so I had gotten to the point where they call it the law of diminishing returns, where you can do a good thing so much that the good thing actually turns bad. And I had to first recognize that. So you have to, if you are in a space where you're kind of like, you might not even realize it, but eventually, you know, the water will start to drown you and you'll be like, wait a minute, something's wrong. So once you get that inkling, something is wrong, really nailing down what's going on here, you know? So like, you know, what's going on here? Am I, is it, is, should I really have this much money saved? You know, or is it like, you know, I understand that, you know, I have enough money for vacation, but the fact that I don't have retirement, is that really a good thing? So having an honest, non-accusatory, non-judgmental conversation with yourself to say, is where I am where I'd like to be? And then if it's not, identifying what components are out of alignment. You know, like, I have all this money saved, but I hardly had, like, I had all this money saved. Literally, I probably had a time, I want to say maybe $300,000-$400,000 saved, right? And $30,000 in my retirement account. And I said, okay, does that make sense, Tiffany? Now, the opposite flipped, cute. But does that make sense that you have not provided for your older self? I call my older self Wanda. For y'all OG dream catchers, if you're listening, you know, Wanda's what I call my old lady self, because there was a study that was done that found that we disassociate from, like, who our older self is. So I said, well, let's lean into it. That's Wanda. Wanda's a, you know, Wanda be like, oh, so Tiffany, young Tiffany got $400,000 saved, but she got 30 for me. Okay. You know, and Wanda was like, that's how we doing it. Okay. And so I realized, like, so I really started to really outline the places that I knew I was out of alignment. And then I had to admit to myself, I did it, although I knew what to do, I had not done it because I was not in an emotional space to do it myself. So once I recognized too, I need help, then I had to acknowledge like, okay, and figure out what type of help did I think I needed. And so for me, I realized if I had the right financial advisor, someone who I can trust, because that's really what it was. What really what it was is I had broken trust with myself because I perceived the mistakes I made in the past as I can't trust you, Tiffany, to make the right choices. Because look, you made that choice and you put us in $35,000 credit card debt. You made that choice and you lost our house. You made that choice. So I had not yet, even though I had forgiven myself, I had not rebuilt the trust with myself. And I said, I don't know how long that's going to take. We don't have all day, Tiffany. So who can you trust? So I literally interviewed about 30 different personal, like financial advisors to find someone who I could put that trust on until I could rebuild the trust with myself. And so her name is Anjali. She's awesome. And so that's what happened. It's that now with Anjali's help, because I trust her, she's just reconfirming what I know. So I'm now rebuilding trust with Tiffany. Like I actually trust Anjali more than almost I trust myself, but slowly but surely I'm even rebuilding that self with myself. Like, see, Anjali said, put this here. You already knew that. You know stuff too, Tiffany. You know, see, Anjali said this, but you know, you were thinking about that 2 years ago. You know stuff too, Tiffany. And so that's what I would say about that, dealing with that emotional component is if you're not where you want to be, get clear about where you're out of alignment, whether you have to write that down or type it up. Ask yourself, do you know the solutions to those problems? Can you do them yourself? Sometimes you can. If you can't, then ask yourself, where can I get that help from? What does that person look like that can help me? And then go seek that help, you know, because, you know, if you seek, you shall really truly find. And then, so as a result, the opposite is true as far as my savings versus my retirement and other investments, you know, and it's not an overnight process because I still struggle as Tiffany to be like, oh, I should do this. And I'm like, wait, let me ask Anjali if it's a good thing. I'm like, girl, you know, but I'm like, we getting there, Tiffany. Hopefully in the next year or so, we will fully have regained the trust in, you don't have to be perfect. You do know what to do. Anjali is there, is great. Cause I asked her one day, I said, well, Anjali, once we set all these things up and it's kind of just basically automatically doing itself, what happens? She said, you won't need me. I was like, she's like, Tiffany, you're not going to need me. And I'm like, okay. So then I'll be able to wean myself off and really lean into my, you know, lean into what I know to be true, which is I know what to do. I just needed a little hand holding. So
this is helping somebody. Yes. I love this conversation. One of the things that I also read was, and I thought, I was like, oh, I like this statement. Self-care is thinking about your future self. A lot of times when you hear the term self-care, we're kind of thinking about right now, mm-hmm. taking care of myself now, go to do spa, whatever. But good self-care is also thinking about your future self. And you kind of broke that down when you talked about your future self, Wanda. And so we all need to be thinking about our future self. What does our future
Willie.
Self?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You got name. Yeah. What y'all gonna say? What's a good old? You gotta give yourself a nice old person name. Willie. And what about you?
Oh, what's mine? Come on, you gotta help me.
Maybe Wilhelmina. Why Yvette? Right.
I like that. Yes, I think we'll take that. I love that. So I think that's great advice. Think about your future self. That's great self-care. In your book, you talk about the 10 steps of financial wholeness. Y'all got to get the book. We'll make sure that we have the links in the description box as well. If you're watching this on YouTube, in the comment section as well, in the bottom half of the video as well. But you definitely want to make sure that you all read her book. It's full of great information. I'm going to talk about this one. In your book, The 10 Steps of Financial Wholeness, you talk about dig out of debt. Talk about that part of your book and why is that important?
Because it is so important that so the first 5 steps of the book really are what I call the foundational steps, right? And so those foundational steps are budgeting, that's number 1, 2, savings, 3, digging out of debt, 5, your credit, and 6, learning how to earn. So these are the foundation for your finances. But digging out of debt is a critical component because it's hard to move forward if something is holding you back, you know? Now, but I had to learn that I had to be more strategic of how I was digging out of debt, you know? But I learned that like, it has to be a core component to the rest of your financial life. Like I call debt-free like a toddler, right? So like, I don't have any mortgages. I don't have any credit card debt. I don't have any student loans. I don't have any car notes. Like, I am debt free, like my nephew Roman. He's 5.
I love that.
And it feels so, because what I love about that, right, is that the money that comes in is mine, except for the responsibilities I have month to month, you know? And when that happens, when you, you know, when you are debt free, it allows you to activate your money towards your goals much faster, you know, that you can start to invest. You know, you can, you know, also too, especially if you want to start a business. Oh my goodness, there's no, it's such a great gift to start a business without debt, because it allows you then to say, our life doesn't have to be as expensive. It gives me some space and room to, I don't have to be as profitable right away.
You could take more risk, right?
Yes.
Yeah, because that stress level, even though it's there, it's different, but you could take more risk.
Exactly.
For sure.
Exactly. And so just, but being mindful for me, I want, the problem that I find that I also, the lesson I had to learn for myself was that I had to learn that debt freedom is not the same thing as wealth. That I, when I was working on my debt freedom journey, I did not bother to learn how to also invest and grow wealth. So when this part of the journey was winding down, I was like, wait, what now? So I wanted people to understand too, that debt freedom is working on your debt is a component of your journey. But I also too want you to be learning how to grow wealth, because growing wealth is actually going to activate your debt freedom even faster. You know, like, it was the last leg of my debt was not paid off by like my day-to-day like savings. It was the Budgetnista had paid me enough. Like, the last leg of my debt was my student loan debt. And the Budgetnista paid me enough that I was able to write a $50,000 check, boom, to pay it off. And I thought, wow, if I had not realized or figured out, you know what, Tiffany, while you're working on debt freedom, also be like taking classes on how to make more money and growing your business. And so once I had enough, I was able to be like, boom, my last bit of debt, student loan debt, one lump sum, versus like the monthly payments that I had paid off the rest of my debt with. So I want people to understand that, like, while you're working on debt freedom, also ask yourself, how can I also learn to grow wealth so I can aid me in the debt freedom, as well as what looks like what life looks like once I'm debt free.
Cool. Good now, some people came to this episode because they bad with money and they want to learn how to get good with money.
Yes.
So for those people who are inspired by what you've shared thus far, what are some first few steps that they can take to start to turn the tide in their direction? We know step one is to get your new book, Get Good with Money. Yeah. Link in the description. From there, what would you advise that person if you were talking to them one-on-one?
I would advise them, honestly, I know people don't want to hear, but you need to start with a budget. You know, like, a budget is the cornerstone for the rest of your financial life. I know it's not as cute as being like, ooh, you know, start trading. I'm like, how you gonna trade if you ain't got no money?
Come on, will you say that again, please?
Because
exactly.
Don't get me wrong. I want you to learn how to invest. You
absolutely
should. But I'm like, if you don't have any money and you spend all of your money and invest in a way that makes you lose. That's what I did. That's why I lost that $35,000. I was like, ooh, let me invest without any fundamentals. And then when I lost everything, I lost everything. I lost my investment. I lost my retirement account. I lost my home. I lost everything. So starting with the cornerstone, which is your budget. A budget is just money in, money out. What does that flow of money currently look like in your life? And if it's not flowing in a way that's conducive to a strong financial life, let's update that and change it. So that's literally why that is step one for Get Good With Money in my book, Get Good With Money, is aside from the mindset stuff, it's learning how to budget. Because once you have that cornerstone, you can build the other components of your financial life on that.
And then you said save like a squirrel.
Yes.
Talk about that. I know a squirrel, I'm assuming like they hide all their little, you know, what is it? Chestnuts? What is
acorns.
It? Acorns. Like in their jaws. So save like a squirrel.
So squirrels are super savvy savers in that not only do they hide their acorns in their jaws, if you look, squirrels, so I live in the Northeast, I live in Jersey. Squirrels are most active during times of abundance. I'm going to say that again. Squirrels are most, they save the most and wow. Work the hardest during times of abundance. Human beings be doing the opposite. This is what we do. You get like, all of a sudden you get a new job that pays you more. You're like, ow, vacation.
New car.
What? Right? Okay. And you're like, so we chill the most and spend the most during abundant times. Because we feel like it's abundant times. Squirrels are like, no, when things are in abundance, that's when you want to save as much as you can and lean into the abundance by trying to extract as much out. You got a new job that pays you more. Try to get that raise. Try to get that overtime, because financial winter will come for you. Because when wintertime comes, what do squirrels do? They live off the acorns they set aside during the abundant times. And so when you're saving like a squirrel, you lean in to abundant times. And when you're in a season, you know, of withdrawal, then you're like, okay, that's okay, because I still have my acorns that I set aside during those abundant times. So I'm going to live off those, you know? And so that's what saving like a squirrel really amounts to, is that like, that you have to understand that the acorns that you save in spring are also for winter.
That's so good, Tiffany.
Good stuff. So good. I mean, let everybody know what else they'll learn when they pick up your book, and also tell them how they can pick up a copy and stay in touch with you.
So when you get the book, Get Good With Money, there are 10 components. What I really love about Get Good With Money is that, yes, I teach the financial fundamentals like budgeting, savings, debt, credit, learning how to earn. The second half of the book is like really the next level, right? It is investing like an insider for both retirement and investing for wealth. It is insurance. That is a question that so many people have, like what does insurance look like and what's the best way to go about it? It's growing your net worth. It's building your money team. So who can you lean into? An attorney, a real estate, and maybe you have an agent for your for insurance. Maybe you have a financial advisor. So I share with you people that you potentially might have on your team and how to find them. And last but not least, estate planning. People are like, I don't have an estate. You do. If you have a bank account, you have an estate. If you have a retirement account at work, you have an estate. If you have a pension, you have an estate. And so what I really love about Get Good With Money, the 10 simple steps to becoming financially whole, is I take you from the first kind of step of budgeting and lead you all the way through to the last and final step of estate planning. And it's just comprehensive. There's homework. I truly believe as a teacher that I don't know all the things. So I actually bring in other educators into the book with me and lean into their like my Anjali, my personal financial advisor. I lean into her for the insurance chapter. Some of our faves, Kevin from Building Bread. I lean into him for the investment chapter for retirement. Courtney, the Ivy investor for the I lean into her for the wealth building. Nativa, you know, we all love. I lean into her for credit. You know, so I really tried. I mean, if anybody follows my brand, you know that I'm one for collaboration.
Yes.
So I really tried to bring in as many people as possible so you could get the, I didn't want to give you what I call a buffet business, where it's just like, you know, like I'm you know, the food, just making food at the buffet place is pretty good. You know, the Italian food is pretty good. No, I wanted you to get the specialty. Like Nativa specializes in credit. That's all she does all day, every day. So I wanted to pull that out of her and have her for that chapter. So I'm just really proud of this book. I just found out it just crossed over the 75,000 book sale mark.
Nice. Oh, congratulations.
Incredible.
Thank you.
Congrats.
I found out that what did they tell me? They said, so if your book in a lifetime sells 25,000 copies, they consider that a job well done.
Wow.
In a lifetime.
75,000.
Yes. Wow. And that literally only a handful of books ever sell 100,000 copies in its first year, let alone a financial book. And so it's just like, honestly, it's been just such a blessing, because this is a book, quite honestly, that I prayed for. I said, I want to leave a guide for the people that listen to and follow the Budgetnista, but I don't know how the guide should go. And then I remember distinctly, literally one day I was waiting for an Uber and it was there and it downloaded. Like the 5 years ago, the very steps that are in here was literally, it was tumbling out. I got a napkin and I just started writing it down like, the Uber's here. And so this is, to me, this is why it's doing what it's doing. Because to me, it's really like, it was a divine download. And I truly believe that the book is through me, not of me, but it's a gift to the people that need it. And so I'm just really blessed overall. So just thank you guys for having
That's
me
awesome.
On and for always being such an amazing support.
For sure. Tell everybody about the podcast, social media, because they want to follow along with you.
I am the Budgetnista on all the things. I don't TikTok, although I did have Budgetnista on TikTok. I thought I might. Then I was like, Todd, I'm sorry. Let me let this kid TikTok. I'm the Budgetnista on Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, Facebook. I do have a podcast, Brown Ambition. Me and my podcast partner, Mandy, we talk about, you know, what it's like to be a brown woman navigating career, business, and money. You can get good with money, literally at the title, getgoodwithmoney.com. And I'm just thinking like, yeah, that's basically it. That's the Budgetnista in a nutshell.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. We appreciate you taking time out of your busy schedule to come and share your wisdom and your story with us today. Thank you.
No, thank you for having me.
Well, there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. It was good.
Oh my gosh. Like, y'all get the book. Huh? Get her book. Again, the links will be everywhere. Wherever you're listening to this, get her book. We have followed Tiffany
whole time.
The entire
all
time.
7 years.
Exactly.
And that we've been in existence.
This is exactly who she is. Yeah. She is big on collaboration, but she's big on giving. Mm-hmm. Like, she gives of her information, her knowledge freely. For sure. So definitely check her out.
All right, guys, listen, get up out of that post-traumatic broke syndrome.
Yes.
And do what you got to do.
Come up with a name for your future self.
Yes. We Willie and Wilhelmina.
Wilhelmina.
What's your name? We want to know. Leave it in the comments section below if you're watching this on YouTube. That's all we got for this time, guys. It's been great. Until next time. Peace.
Bye, y'all.